Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Grounded Reason podcast. Today, we're going to talk about something that matters very much out there to cord cutters, people who have, you know, cut the cord on cable and are saving money by streaming video using alternative services like Netflix, Sling TV, etc. One complaint most all of us have we still have to buy internet service from these same companies who have ripped us off for years for our cable TV and satellite content. However, rule changes this year have made things, or at least the future, a little bit brighter out there for people concerned about being able to have affordable internet access. The FCC basically put rules into effect saying that content providers are all to be treated equally, that no internet service provider can throttle or block content for any means, and it forbade this concept of fast lanes, which basically means companies like Netflix or Hulu or any company providing video content or any content for that matter can't be charged more for what they're providing. And the reason for that is if you have a company, an ISP that also serves video content, you don't want them charging more money to their competitors that aren't an ISP. So you don't want Comcast charging Hulu exorbitant fees to deliver their content, because then that's just going to increase the price for the customer. Moreover, it eliminates the control that ISPs could possibly have over an open and free internet. Now, last week, we asked the question, what will this look like, or will this stand in the face of a new administration? And we mentioned who was going to be overseeing the FCC transition, Dr. Jeffrey Eisenach. At the time, we knew he had some telecom connections, but I wasn't sure how deep it ran, so I spent this week doing a lot of research on the gentleman, and that's what Joel and I are going to discuss today, and we're going to find out how bleak this future could be with Eisenach calling the shots. We're also going to talk about what we can all do to fix it. But before we get started, remember, subscribe on iTunes. Helps us out in the rankings. All you have to do is click that subscribe button. If you're digging the show, leave us a 5-star review. Gives us some visibility. We would love that. Also, thanks to those out there who have already left a review and subscribed. Really, really appreciated. I'm going a bit long on this intro, so let's just get the show started. So last week, Joel and I started discussing the FCC transition and who they put in place, whose name I unfortunately mispronounced.
Yeah. I don't remember what.
I can't remember how I said it, but it's Jeffrey Eisenach.
Yeah.
Is heading up the transition for the FCC. And it brought worry to me, for one, because this guy is a noted hater of any type of like FCC regulation, especially when it comes to net neutrality. He's been waving the flag like to fight net neutrality the whole
way. Testified in front of Congress.
Yes, he did. But I decided to go do a bit of digging to see where this guy comes from, just so we know really what to expect.
Let's be honest. The real reason you did it is because you wanted to get me really angry.
Well, yeah, that too. Because if you voted for Mr. Trump because you wanted change, fine. Okay. And because one of the things he promised was draining the swamp.
Yep.
We're draining the swamp. And so with this guy, do you know where he started? Or at least, like, I mean, sure, he started. He might have had some dealings before this, but where he really showed up on the political radar?
Where he got his footing in the industry.
Yeah, it was working for Newt Gingrich.
Yeah, and let's make no mistake, politics is an industry.
Oh, definitely.
And especially a guy like this. He's been working, well, he started with Gingrich in 1993.
Yeah, so back, like, Contract of America days.
Yep.
Like, in the mid-90s, if you know.
Yeah.
Kids asked your parents.
Yeah, so there was this decade a while back called the 1990s.
Right, back in the 1900s.
Yeah, the latter part of that. But, and it's commonly referred to as the Republican Revolution, which is basically 1994, Contract with America, Gingrich masterminded a outing of a very large, I forget what the number was, of the seats of the Democrats in the House of Representatives.
Yeah, well, they had the Contract with America, and, you know, they pretty much... It was the first time in a while where Congress really was in the spotlight.
Well, the real, so from a poli-sci perspective, like, the big change was, I forget who said this, but up until then, the common thinking was all politics is local, mm-hmm. right? Like, so if you wanna get people to vote for you, the way you get them to vote for you is you solve their local problem, because right. their local problem is what puts money in their pocketbook, bread in their belly.
Especially, you know, in Congress. I mean, that was the game.
I mean, that's the game. It's different when you're talking about, you know, the president and so on, but particularly the House.
Especially even, the House, yes.
Right? Like, because the Senate
is local.
Even,
I mean, you're only talking about
extremely local.
A couple hundred thousand people.
Yes, yeah, I think 350,000 right. per representative. And so what Gingrich and that group did
You mean the Congress?
The Congress. Gotcha. Or
the Republican
the contract
Congress.
With America. Right. What it really did was lay forth a national agenda. Mm-hmm. So it flipped things around, saying, hey, we're going to make this a thing, and we're going to try and take a whole lot of seats at one time by putting forth a national agenda rather than a local agenda. And that is when our friend Jeff comes into the picture.
Yeah, because Gingrich, he had political action committee. Basically,
yep.
you know, they collect a bunch of money and they funnel it into various political causes.
Yeah.
Well, Gingrich ran something called the GOPAC. It was basically the GOP action committee, I think.
Yeah, I think that's what it's
something along
for.
Those lines. Its main mission was really identifying Republican leaders for Congress, teaching best practices. You know, you ever notice how the Republicans tend to be I think they're better at it than the Democrats. They're in lockstep with the talking points. They all have the same messaging. The Democrats, there's groups, there's pockets of Democrats in that. But the Republican Party as a whole kind of, you know, they're very good at staying in lockstep.
Stay in on message. And that does date back to this time period.
And the GOPAC has a lot to do with that.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's basically their playbook.
And I'll probably say this a couple of times throughout this, but I think it's important, like the irritation with what we're discussing here that you can at least hear in my voice and probably hear a little in Dennis's is not it's not with GOPAC, it's not with Mr. Gingrich, it's not even with how do you pronounce his name again?
Eisenach. Jeffrey Eisenach. Dr. Jeffrey Eisenach.
It's with the hypocrisy of the idea of draining the swamp and then putting this person who's been in the swamp.
Right.
He's been the swamp thing for 22 years.
Because he headed GOPAC for Gingrich. And just to get a little bit of background on why this is not necessarily a good thing is, in like 93, he went to GOPAC and he had this idea it was called Renewing American Civilization. And essentially,
this is Eisenach who did this.
Well, no, this is Gingrich. Yeah. This is Gingrich. So he came under ethics review by Congress. Because if you're a nonprofit, what's it, a 501c3?
Yes.
You cannot be partisan. You can't, you know,
That's right.
Push money into one side of politics or be openly political. So what he would do is find ways to get tax-free money funneled into politics. Now, one way he did this was with this renewing American civilization idea that he had. He was going to be teaching at a university, and you're like, okay. But he wanted to basically satellite feed the courses, and that was going to cost roughly about $300,000. So he had people in GOPAC funnel money to Kennesaw State, which was going to push, you know, which was going to actually have the course. And, you know, eventually Kennesaw State was uncomfortable with it when they saw, like, the political nature of the courses he was teaching. So GOPAC was responsible for basically funneling this money, getting this money, raising the funds for this quote-unquote nonpartisan course. Well, you know, as I said, Kennesaw State had some issues with it. So in June of 93, the GOPAC executive, Mr. Jeffrey Eisenach, and two assistants decided to, you know, run the course, and they were going to step down. He was going to step down from GOPAC at that point, but GOPAC paid half of his salary until like September. So right. He was getting paid by the Political Action Committee while he was doing
this.
Well, he wasn't teaching to fund it, to get the money to fund it so Gingrich could teach the course. Because
right.
It's going to cost, because they're pushing it on a satellite feed, and I think the number was it was going to cost about, you know, $300,000 in the first year to fund this course to do that satellite feed. Because, you know, of course, okay, big deal. But the fact that he is nationally broadcasting this course, it's going to cost a bit of money.
Right.
So, I mean, and this all shows up in an ethics review that they did, you know, around that time. I think it was like mid-90s when they started doing this ethics review. So eventually the course was moved to like Reinhard College in 94 after, you know, complaints from the school. And that's when Eisenach started the Progress and Freedom Foundation, you know, and basically it was another 501c3. So Gingrich, you know, so basically they could finance this course under this PFF, the Progress and Freedom Foundation, which Eisenach headed.
Right.
So he left GOPAC, you know, tried to get this course set up to like get donors to come in through the Kennesaw State to do it. Kennesaw State got wind and shut it down. So then they formed PFF, which he headed.
And ran it through a different university.
Well, no, it went to a different university and then started a 501c3 right. To pull the funds in. So, I mean, so Eisenach starts this group, and the ethics report said that they spent $900,000 in tax-deductible donations on the course over the two-year period, much of it from Newt Gingrich supporters.
I think, again, just to remind everyone of who this is the person who is currently in charge of the transition for the FCC.
Right. Yeah. He is basically going to be deciding who to put in place and you know, appointee positions, maybe even deciding a bit on the policy, because while all we've talked about thus far is some of his lobbying, you know, abilities, PFF eventually turns into a technological
think tank.
Right. Ish. One of those ish think tanks where they're, you know, where they kind of hide where the funds are coming from.
And not a reputable one.
Well, none of them really. It's almost to the point where none of them are. It's not many of them in politics anyway, because they'll try to get, you know, you'll get a bunch of companies with their pet cause. They'll fund a think tank to write a paper.
Yeah, but I mean, there's certainly some that are considered more reputable than
others. Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, this is rampant. I mean, I guess it's because we're talking about telecom, and in telecom, it's rampant with the money that's behind some of these think tanks. But anyway, I mean, and if this isn't just some partisan blathering here, I mean, because in the end, the House overwhelmingly voted 395-28 to reprimand Gingrich for this, and they fined him $300,000. 395-28. So I'm sure there was a lot of Republicans in there.
I don't know of many things short of war that the House gets
that much more behind.
Yeah, uniformly behind.
And Gingrich was a Republican speaker at one point. So, and okay, and here's a quote from Republican Nancy Johnson. "Today, we concluded this case by imposing a heavy penalty on the leader of the House. It is a tough penalty, unprecedented, and appropriate."
I think I remember this. I think this was right around 1996.
Yeah. And she said that on the House floor.
Yeah.
So, and he lost his speakership not soon after that.
Yeah. And that's when I think I remember, or why I think I remember it. Because in 94, I mean, Gingrich was a political rock star.
Oh, yeah.
Which is to say, not really a rock star.
He shaped the before the Tea Party. Up until the Tea Party, he shaped the modern Republican Party. Yeah. That was his party.
He also changed a lot of the way the Democrats did business.
Yeah.
Right? Like, because they had to adapt to how politics was then being, you know, played. And Jeff Eisenach was right in the thick of this.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And that's like, and the thing is, so he's running this PFF. And after all of that, they decided to, as we were talking, they pivoted a bit. And their mission statement became, it evolved into, they wanted to educate policymaker, opinion leaders, and public and the public about issues associated with technological change based on a philosophy of limited government, free market, and individual sovereignty.
Now, you got to think about the time period when this is going on. I believe, again, this is after 1996, so this is right in the dot-com boom.
Right.
So because if you're doing, if you're doing most anything, you somehow you were going to end up involved in the internet. Right.
And that's exactly what happened. And if you look at a and this is pulled from SourceWatch, which is a good they basically try to compile and figure out where all the funding is coming from for a lot of these 501c3s and think tanks and such. Well, it's a who's – basically, they said that the Progress of Freedom Foundation's list of corporate donors reads who's who's list of telecommunications industry to the tune of $3 million per year.
This is bad.
Okay, so let's go here. We got at the time, okay, you had America Tech Foundation, SBC, Bell South. All of those are AT&T.
Yep.
Okay. They all became AT&T. They all, you know. And then you have Verizon Communications, Bell Atlantic, GTE Corp, MCI. Those are all now Verizon. Quest, Comcast, Time Warner, AOL, the National Cable Television Association.
These are all the associations.
Yeah. You know, Telecommunications Industry Association. These are basically big telecom is what's funding this thing. So basically it's, hey, we need some smart people to write some policy papers. Here's a load of cash PFF. Get to it. It's kind of what's going on.
And if you look at it, it really is the players that we talk about all the time on this.
Oh, yeah. And it's funny you should mention because recently, okay, bit of background. PFF shut down in 2010. And he went on to work for a couple other think tanks. Yep. NERA is one. And, well, NERA is important to this because they were working for the GSMA, which is basically it's a trade association for mobile operators all over the world, like so mobile telephone companies, right. Telecom.
Yeah.
Eisenach apparently, because the Times recently did a piece on his connections with the telecom industry, so I guess he was kind of getting nervous, and they like to hop on the Twitter over there.
The old Twitter.
They did. So he, this is what he tweets. He tweets, not wanting to engage on this, but the facts are, not a lobbyist, not consulting for Verizon, no consulting business before the FCC at all.
Right.
Okay. Now, okay, that last one we know is complete bunk because we just talked about
him doing that.
Getting funds to teach this, course for GOPAC. Right. And then, forming PFF.
Specifically for that reason.
Specifically to funnel funds to do this course once the original school kind of felt a little bit uneasy about the politics of it. Right. And because they wanted to remain nonpartisan, they didn't want to be involved because they knew what was going on. These guys teaching a course and they don't want it to look like they're propping up the GOP at this university because the university is a nonprofit. I mean, it was a state university.
Yeah.
So
yeah, it's pretty straightforward.
Yeah. So okay. So he puts that on Twitter, and I immediately I've been researching this. So I was like, okay, I've looked at papers. This is guys written. I know this is like true. So I tweeted, and if you guys want to, like, and I would love for this to get out. So you can follow Grounded Reason on Twitter at Grounded Reason. Yeah. Retweet this thing. Get it going. Because I retweeted this document out there that he wrote where he starts quoting, you know, his different, like, where he's written papers before.
Yep.
And he's quoting himself because he did this paper for Facebook. Facebook hired him to write something. And he quoted, like, on behalf of Verizon, his name, something he wrote, like, six times.
Yeah,
After he said, I've never consulted for Verizon. Now, here's the technicality. He was working for NERA, hired by GSMA, which is the Trade Foundation, for Verizon.
He subcontracted through another company for Verizon. Dennis.
That's working for Verizon.
That's totally different. That's totally different.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I mean, let's be serious here.
So
now, the guy is, you know... Oh, man. Am I going to get my first explicit rating on this episode?
Maybe. It might happen.
Are you
going to
get me revved up
enough? I feel
it
building. But I love it. I wonder, that's probably why he started the sentence with, not wanting to engage on this.
Yeah, that's like, that's like when you go, you know, I don't want to be rude, but.
Exactly.
Right? Like, that is never.
And when anytime somebody says that, the rudest thing is going to come out of their face.
The nastiest thing comes right out. And you're like, oh, that's the person you really are. Got it.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, and I really want to get to, I'm like, my foot is twitching. I want to get to his testimony in front of Congress. So, like,
oh, I know. We will, because he did that. I mean, and I would love for that.
We're in a timeline, so we're still back. We're still back in like 2010, and we got to get to 2014.
Right. Well, this tweet actually happened this week.
I know,
and I put that out because I just wanted to kind of, because he's
the guy's straight up lying, right? Like that's a lie.
A total lie.
Right. I'm not. Honestly, don't like calling people out like that, but that's a lie.
He's obviously worked for Verizon. He's quoted, he's written, not only does he work for Verizon, he's written papers for other companies where he quotes work that he's done for Verizon.
Yeah, he cites himself in that capacity.
And then tweeted saying it's right here. Not wanting to engage on this. Like, not a lobbyist. Not consulting for Verizon. No consulting business before FCC at all.
Yeah. You realize if I was listening to this episode and I was driving along, I'd have to pull over. I'd be so angry.
So this no consulting bit. The company he worked for is called NERA Economic Consulting.
I mean,
it's in the name of the company.
It's in the name. Just pick a different word. Like, that's just lazy lying, which I detest.
It's
that.
Gaslighting is what it is. It's like, it's, you know, gaslighting, right? It's like when you lie and someone calls you on it and you just kind of swear by the lie anyway and try to make the person think they're crazy.
I used to do that with my parents when I would sneak out or something. But, you know, it never worked. It's not going to work here, right? Like, because, I mean, it's just, this is not a thing that people forget.
I hope not.
Because, here's what I mean by people forget. People forget that in this day and age, the things you do are very easy to check.
Yeah. Well, you figure, since he's like, you know, with PFF, with, you know, their digital change, technological change, that he would know how the internet works. And how when you say something on there, even if you delete it, which he didn't, it's still there. It gets captured and it's there for good. It's like once you say something out there, it's on the record.
Right. Yeah. So I'm always dumbfounded when someone says a comment that absolute, that is so false. But it seems to be, you know, a growing trend.
Okay, so he's worked for telecom. Okay, you know, obviously, you know, we've seen net neutrality. The opponents of net neutrality tend to be, and when we say net neutrality, we're just really talking about open internet. We're talking about no blocking, no throttling, and, you know, no fast lanes. Basically, you can't charge Netflix more because they're putting video out there. You can't charge
based on content.
Exactly. Like, because you don't want a cable company sitting there charging Netflix more money for their content because they're competing when it comes to video. So
yeah, and in brief summary of, like, what my objections around the ideas of, like, getting rid of current net neutrality policies, that, like, net neutrality policy as it stands is a check against, like, corporate interests and against the state, right? Like, mm-hmm. There's potential for censorship on either side as long as there's the ability to throttle or charge more based on content, because if whoever, right, whether it be the government or corporate interest that owns the, you know, the pipes, if they don't like what you're saying, you know, they are going to penalize you and not penalize your competitors.
Right. And we're in a precarious situation as it is, because while it is not a technical monopoly, it's definitely a regional monopoly when it comes to internet access.
Yeah.
Because very few, like maybe 30, I think it's in the 30s, 30 some odd percent of people actually have more than one choice when it comes to broadband in this country, which is crazy. And I saw it coming over today, coming here today. I saw a report that showed in the third quarter, 99% of broadband ads at net ads to, you know, broadband subscribers went to the cable industry, and Comcast gobbled up a ton of those. Charter's gobbled up some as well, but what's happening is your Verizons and your ATTs are, it's expensive to lay fiber. Yeah. So they're basically just putting it in big markets, and they're just essentially letting their DSL wither on the vine.
Yeah.
And those folks with DSL are going over to cable companies for their internet.
Yeah, I think we talked about it on a previous episode. Right. So, I don't remember which one.
And so that gets into a really scary situation when you have the threat of somebody like Eisenach basically saying what the FCC policy is going to be once it transitions over to the Trump administration. And you're essentially, if you got rid of net neutrality, these cable companies have, you know, they're controlling communication.
Yeah. Yeah. And so when we get to the testimony in a minute, that's going to be a big part of what we talk about.
Right, right.
But go ahead.
Well, so, okay. No, do you want to go ahead and do you have it there or?
Oh, I can bring it up. All right. So basically what happens, September 17th, 2014, mm-hmm. goes to testify in front of the Senate Committee on why net neutrality matters, protecting consumers and competition through meaningful open internet rules. And so he was a quote-unquote visiting scholar at that point from the American Enterprise Institute.
Oh, yeah. And AEI, that's another one that, yeah, that it, same ball game.
Yeah, Shill Corp.
Yep.
Yeah. So they, I'm just going to go through the first point and then feel free to hop in on the second one. But the first one's the one that really, really irritates me. So he says here, my testimony today advances three major points. First, net neutrality regulation cannot be justified on grounds of enhancing consumer welfare or protecting the public interest. All right, so I'll break there. He's saying that it cannot be, right?
Well, okay, real quick.
Yeah, sure.
Right there. Okay.
Because I have a feeling you have a problem with that part.
Well, the public.
My problem is with his argument for why.
Okay. For the public interest thing. Okay, well, go ahead. You say why. Let's say why, and then I'll.
All right. Because I think they're going to end up being the same thing. So he goes on to say, rather, it is best understood as an effort by one set of private interests to enrich itself by using the power
of the state to obtain free services from another. A classic example of what economists term rent seeking. So let me just give me. I'm gonna.
You love economics, so you need to.
Yeah, I'm gonna get a boil if I don't talk about this. sorry, listeners. What he's saying there basically is that the providers of the service, meaning the telecom industry, right, are competing in this net neutrality argument with content providers.
And by telecom, we also lump cable in there.
Cable and telecom. And what he's saying is that the current net neutrality laws are basically just a power grab, that's what they mean by rent-seeking activity, where basically what he's arguing is that the content providers are trying to get free use of this service that is the cabling for the internet.
And that's the funny part is, okay, I could see this argument if you roll back the clock to, like, 1995.
Well, the argument makes half sense.
Well, half sense if the internet isn't, like,
fundamental to life.
Which it is now. Right. We're in the information age. And so that's what I'm saying. Like, in 1995, okay, I could maybe give this argument a pass because the internet was looked at as kind of some luxury item at that time.
He goes, the key point in the whole discussion, right, to me, is where he says, let's see, cannot be justified on the grounds of enhancing the consumer's welfare or protecting the public interest. That's where I find this objectionable.
Objectionable.
What he is arguing in this rent seeker statement is that Netflix, we'll use them because we use them as our common example of a content.
That's
provider.
The one everyone knows, you know.
Yeah, everyone knows.
Lots
that.
Of people.
You know, Netflix is trying to swipe a free service from, let's say, Comcast and Verizon to provide its service at the same rate as everyone else, and Comcast and Verizon are at this horrible disadvantage because they can't charge Netflix more. What he's failing to mention is that on the side of content providers, he is radically oversimplifying the market.
Oh, yeah.
Because what is on that side is all of the rest of us. So Dennis and I, for example, are content providers, and that without net neutrality, we could be throttled.
Uh-huh.
Or if you decided to start a blog, you could be throttled, right? Or Walmart. Or
charged more because they don't like your content.
Exactly. Everything in between the Netflix or the Walmarts or the whoever's, all the way down to the little old Joels and Dennis's of the world, are part of that market. And they are content providers that are all using this equally. So it is, by definition, in the public interest.
Oh, and that's the thing. Yes, it is by definition. But if you really want to know what the public interest is, you can go to the horse's mouth.
Yeah.
Because the FCC is open for comment.
Yeah.
When you have...
That's another great point. The rulemaking process does nothing but allow the public to...
So it's not like public interest is kind of like this nebulous, you know, rhetoric you can toss out there.
No, people knew all about
this. You can measure it. You can look at it. And that's exactly what happened, because they opened up public comments back in... around that same time in 2014. And I don't know if you've listened to the AI episode. But you can do some wonderful stuff with artificial intelligence. And they basically ran all 800,000 comments through a natural language processor, basically trying to figure out, like, you know, look for patterns and meaning and everything else. And this is done, like, this is out there on the sunlightfoundation.com website. And they estimated that less than 1% of comments were clearly opposed to net neutrality. Out of 800,000, only 1% was clearly against net neutrality.
Yeah, I mean, we, I think in our last episode, one of us said, and I really do believe this, that the internet is as close to the First Amendment incarnate is as possible, right? Like, it is free speech.
Right.
It is the way we can all communicate. And I know that's, like, ethereal and, like, everybody needs to hug a tree after I say it.
Yeah.
But
it's true.
But it's true, right? And it's true at a level where we should stop trying to accept or reason through these silly arguments that on their surface say, oh, it's not in the public interest. Well, that's a given. It's in it's the definitely, public interest.
Yes, the public has spoken, and 1% of them maybe were against it. But, you know, the other 99% clearly stated to the FCC that they are, favor of net neutrality.
I'll give you another example. We have to step outside of the country for a minute, but just take what happened in Iran 2.5-3 years ago,
mm-hmm.
where 3 years ago with the Arab Spring.
Oh yeah,
where the internet was the only viable way of communicating,
definitely in the public interest, right there,
and it was in the public interest, and like so, it's one of those things where like the ability to communicate amongst the populace freely. I can't think of anything that's more. See, in the
and I think
interest.
That's the fundamental difference between the thinking of us and the 99% of the public that wrote into the FCC
right.
and Mr. Eisenach is he looks at the internet as purely an economic vehicle
right.
for business.
And it is that.
It is that. But
it's not just that.
Exactly. The telephone is for business as well. But it's also more than that.
Right.
So, and that's really, I think that's the fundamental difference right there is he's looking at this from a purely economic standpoint and not as, like, he doesn't see the internet as something that's as up there with, you know, electricity, which it is at this point.
Well, let's do a little thought experiment just for giggles, okay? Let's rewind the clock 20 years. Right? And let's say some magic technology was invented to where you could throttle or delineate and charge more based on analog phone content, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, just, yeah, imagine that world.
Yeah. Would we allow that as a society? And of course the answer is no.
Right.
Right. Like if I wanted to get on the phone with my sister or my buddy or whatever and talk whatever smack I want to about the government or Comcast or Verizon or whoever, like, and all of a sudden my like voice quality started to die out.
Right.
Right. Like, no, that's unacceptable.
And I mean, we got into this situation because when broadband – because originally DSL lines were phone modems. Like if you would call into a BBS, still – because it was called Title II, Common Carrier.
Yeah.
Basically, you could not – you had to treat everyone as – everyone's conversation as equal. You couldn't turn people away. You had to provide, you know, that service at a price that was regulated by the FCC. But cable came along.
Yeah.
And cable – It was cable television,
right.
And that fell under Title I, which is an information service, because you don't have to have cable. And not only that, but some of the content providers, some of the cable companies actually owned some of the content providers that are on there.
Sure.
So it was considered an information service. Well, then they started delivering internet over that cable, and they never moved it over to Title II. It stayed as an information service. And then in like the mid-2000s, they actually moved DSL and all telecom lines over to Title I information service, which is kind of like the wrong way to go. But they were at that time, even 2004-5, still internet is kind of looked at as more of a – not a necessity.
Right.
You know, today I mean, some may disagree. I don't see how, because we're in the information age, and if you don't have the internet, you are at a severe disadvantage in the job market, in just knowledge, period.
I believe there's man, I'd have to go look. So don't quote me on this, but I think there's 3.5 billion people that participate on the internet now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's kind of a big deal. Yeah. I don't know if anyone's heard of it.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's gone past just simple economics.
Yeah. It's a tremendous thing. And so,
with the First Amendment, like you said earlier, that is one of the mediums right now where the First Amendment is really.
Yeah. My other, you know, pet saying that I heard once before was the internet is the collective of all human knowledge, right? Like, yeah. If it ain't on the internet, as far as I know, it doesn't exist, right? Like, if I can't find it.
Pixar didn't happen.
Yeah, that's right. Just didn't happen. So anyways, that's the first comment he has. And if you can't tell, we disagree.
Oh, yeah. I think, yeah. Was that clear? I hope. I hope that wasn't too convoluted.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes we're a little, you know,
yeah,
sly it is, in our comments.
Sometimes I'm a bit nuanced.
Yeah. Yeah, when I think Dennis, I think nuance. So do you want to go into the second one?
Definitely.
Go for it.
No, okay. Oh, I thought you were going to roll with this one.
You read better than I do.
Do I? No. Come now. I have to pull it up.
Did you just say come now? What are you, 80? Oh, that's funny. Like, so the other day, while you're getting that, like, I was, we had some friends over. It was our cousins, actually. And I was telling a story, and I was like, I was trying to say, like, when Ann and I, you know, went up to bed.
Mm-hmm.
And for some reason, I went, well, when we decided to retire. For the evening. And they're like, yes. Oh, I and my, you know, Erman, her kerchief, and I and my cat.
Yeah, did you have like a, right? like a velvet robe?
I had a smoking pipe.
Yeah, your smoking and jacket,
like,
yeah, on.
Exactly. I was like, God, why did I just say it that way? What's wrong with me?
So, I got it. Okay. So, his second point was, the potential cost of net neutrality regulation are both sweeping and severe. And extend far beyond a simple transfer of wealth from one group to another.
All right. Now, all of that, here's the thing. Anyone with, in my opinion, any bit of knowledge on any of this would say that's a lot of words that don't mean a thing.
Yeah, he's really kind of just repeating his first point, kind of.
Well, frankly, all of those terms are subjective. So, like, severe, what does that mean? You know. Why broad sweeping? What does that mean? Right? Like, and does that mean that they're bad? Right? Like,
yeah, he's nearly not saying anything.
No,
here.
it's a non-statement. So I kind of just skipped to the third one.
Yeah.
Right.
But the fact that he made that, like, my three main points.
Right.
Number two, you can just completely ignore. Yeah. Because there's two adjectives and I'm repeating the first
one.
Thing.
And it's a point. Right. I think it's not a legitimate point, but
it's a point.
But he has a thought.
And if you have a DeLorean and you go back to 1995, I'd probably agree with him.
Right. You might agree, right? Yeah.
So,
Maybe.
So, okay. So third, legitimate policy concerns about the potential use of market power to disadvantage rivals or harm consumers can best be addressed through existing antitrust and consumer protection law and regulations.
Okay. So I will say this.
That's a legitimate point.
Yeah, it's
given...
It's not bad. I mean, I disagree with regard to net neutrality because I think it is easier to address it through the FCC.
And that's why he's saying this,
yeah.
Because he knows if you throw it into, like, the Federal Trade Commission.
Or the Department of Justice, because it could be either or. But, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's just antitrust is difficult.
It's under FTC, right?
Well, both. Technically, all antitrust can go through one or the
other. Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, and it's really weird how they work.
But it's so hard to get – because you could easily –
Oh, they're both really difficult.
Well, yeah. You could easily make the argument, the way the law is set up, that there isn't a technical monopoly
Yeah.
Because
there's not.
Because, right? Yeah, because Comcast doesn't have 51% of the market.
No.
But if you're living in a state and you can only pick one provider, right. To that's, you, that's a monopoly.
What it comes down to is the definition of the market.
Right. Right. Like, and that's so what it is. And they would fall, if it went to the FTC, nothing would fall under antitrust because there's enough companies out there in the country.
Right. You'd have to get someone who is willing to hear the argument of a, and you'd have to make a persuasive argument of defining the market narrowly. And that's hard.
Yeah.
And so I don't disagree that antitrust laws could handle the problem. And it's possible. It's just far less effective mm-hmm. than handling it through the FCC.
Yeah, and that's what this is. It's basically a punt because they know that.
Yeah. Yeah, so first point, invalid. Second point, blather. Third yes. point, almost a valid point.
I would say that it's a valid point.
I would take it under advisement, but not I would practical. Disagree.
Just
right?
just yeah. not practical.
Yeah, so like, again, I just want to point out for anyone who's listening, which hopefully some of you still are.
I would hope so.
Yeah, hopefully.
I know.
Well, at least we get to drink beer. That's if they're true. Not. But this is the gentleman that is leading the transition mm-hmm. for the FCC. And maybe it's important that yes. we actually get into what
they drain the swamp is. And then this guy's there.
Right, right. Like, he was actually, I think he's the one who filled up the swamp.
You know, like, what's left when you drain the swamp?
Oh, not this one.
A quagmire.
Yeah.
See, I say that and no one gets it.
Yeah, I get it.
It's, but, because you see, a quagmire is really kind of like a loose, liquefied ground on, when you actually drain the swamp. That's actually the technical definition of quagmire. So it's like a good, it's like a play on words.
No,
everyone looks at me like I'm insane when I say that.
Well, I mean, I get it, man. It's just when you have to explain it. No, I get it. There's less water in a quagmire. I'm with you.
Yeah, but it's like you're every time you drain a swamp, you're literally left with a quagmire.
And I understand plays okay. on words.
Right.
Just jokes you have to explain. That's all I'm saying.
It's a good one.
Oh man, sorry, I laughed too hard in the microphone. But anyway, so really, really quick, I you kind of alluded to this earlier, but I think people should know, and we probably should be explicit, like, what is the general authority of the person who's in charge of the transition? And my understanding is that it is to do some of the high level appointments for like the at the FCC.
Right.
Are they SESs? I don't know if they're actually
government. No, they're appointees, right.
So they're different, but
he appoints,
but it's the high level employees.
He kind of figures out, he sorts through, he tries to recommend the people who are running the trans, because you think
he's
going
to put like-minded people
there
in
are
place.
Thousands of people that need to be put into positions in the federal government.
Yeah.
The president,
4,000 in the White House, or 2,000 in the White House staff alone.
Right. So the president-elect, you know, he is, you know, yeah. delegating that out, and oh, it's yeah. to these transition people.
There's no way to do it without
exactly
delegating.
And so it's these transition people who are going to, you know, go through and find the people who are supposed to go in and actually, you know, look at what policy was in place before. And what needs to change? And this guy doing that, frankly, terrifies me.
Well, and that's something I want to say, because this, out of the, I don't know, six people that listen to us, probably a couple of them voted for President-elect Trump. And so,
and which I said, if you're voting for change, great.
It is what it is.
This
right?
doesn't really sound like change to me. And if you're that person, I would be ticked. I would be pissed about this.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't get an E for pissed.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I'm trying to keep a sub E.
Yeah, we're trying to keep sub E. We're straight PG-13 here.
Right.
But, like, the that's really what I wanted to drive home, is that this, you know, it's a whole nother thing. And maybe at some other point we'll talk about, like, President-elect Trump, you know, on a different episode. What we have in previous episodes. But this isn't about him becoming the president. This is about who he's put in charge of that transition.
And to be fair, FCC. This is the guy that did the Bush-Cheney. He was involved in the Bush-Cheney one, too.
That's another thing.
Right.
In terms of, like, draining the swamp, he did the exact same job for Bush 43.
Right. And which is probably why DSL Telecom got lumped into Title I in 2005.
It's not a really, curvy line to draw that. So my point is, this is a political industry operative. Right? Oh, this person is not an outsider. This person is not draining the swamp. This person is not going to change things for the better for the rest of us.
So this is what I suggest. Whether you're a Trump supporter or not, I really don't think it comes down to that. I think that this is an issue that 99% of the people are behind.
Yeah, if you value the internet in its current state, where you and people like you can produce content and put it out there for people to read or see or listen to, then this is an issue you should care about.
Right. And I think if enough of us get on, President-elect Trump's radar with this, that he doesn't seem unreasonable enough to where because he ran a populist campaign. If the population is telling him, that we don't want, foxes in the hen house, we don't want, Verizon, Comcast having control over our internet, then
at least has to give people pause.
Exactly. So you can write him actually at 1717 Pennsylvania Avenue Northwest, Washington D.C. 20006.
Yep. And that's where the transition team is located.
That exactly. And I would write it Trump Pence transition team is the attention there. And it will, send a stack of letters. Because, and as Joel said in a previous podcast, writing.
Oh, man.
Or even typing and putting it in an envelope, just something physical, really does. I mean, if they got a pile of papers on their desk.
I was reading another thing from a Hill staffer. They said physical letters, big, big deal.
Mm-hmm.
But another thing that's calling. A big deal, calling.
Yep.
People listen, and you're not going to talk to President-elect Trump.
No, you're going to staffer.
But you're going to talk to a staffer, and that staffer's going to bring it up in the staff meeting.
Right. And so that you can always call your congressman. I'll put a link in the show notes on how to find out which one. Senate would be a big deal, too.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's kind of easier to the Senate is kind of it's a great as we've seen over the past 8 years. It's a great mechanism to stall legislation.
Yeah, that's their whole thing. I forget which of the founding fathers said it was like the cooling water for the boiling tea that is the House or something like that.
Yes, yes.
It's so the Senate is meant chill things.
Yeah, because the House is all like,
House is a bunch of us.
Get
right?
it done.
The House is a bunch of lunatics. And I don't mean this House of Representatives.
Just in general.
Just in general.
It is like, the people's house.
It is the people's house. We are crazy. The Senate is like, a bunch of more chilled out folks, they have more serious responsibilities.
Yeah, well, and that's the rules. The Senate rules are just set up.
They're just different.
For the minority.
Yeah.
I mean, to really kind of have
it has a lot more sway.
Yeah. So either way.
Yeah.
Congressman.
Any of those.
Any of those avenues, just load it up. Let them know you are not happy with this.
Heck, even getting on the tweet. Dennis was talking about earlier would be a good thing.
Yeah, like, just if you want to do that, just follow at Grounded Reason and look. I think it was on. I'll give you the day. It was this week, but at Grounded Reason, and it was like the 13th or 14th. It's 3 days from today, which is when we're recording on Thursday. The what day is today? Thursday.
17th.
Yeah, Thursday the 17th. So yeah, so 3 days before Thursday the 17th. Math, the 14th, and then you can see you'll be able to see that tweet. Go ahead and retweet that tweet. Get it out there. Get it going.
Yeah, just make it stink in general.
Yeah,
right? Like,
cause a ruck.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so I'm going to pull the soapbox out from under myself and say,
I'm keeping my soapbox.
All right, you can.
All right.
You can stand on it this week.
Sounds
like Joel will be standing there all week.
All week.
And then Monday, we'll see if he wants to come down. Okay, so, you know, basically that's it. Write your congressman, send President-elect Trump's transition team a letter, let them know this is not such a good idea. You keep, you know, Mr. Eisenach, Dr. Eisenach, I think he's a PhD, he can do the job. Just make sure that there's some oversight there on what he's putting in place.
Yeah.
Because we fought hard to get an open and fair internet.
Yeah.
And I'd like to keep it that way.
His track record for this sort of stuff is not good.
No, not at all. So I think we've covered all we can here.
Yeah.
I'm Dennis Restaro.
This is Joel Reeves.
Fight the power. All right. Thanks for listening, everybody. I will put those links for how to find your representative in Congress and the Senate in the show notes. Also, if you have any questions for us, we'd love to hear from you. We might even play it on the air. You can give us a call at 650-TALK-GRP. Leave a voicemail with your question, your comments. You can email us at groundedreason.com. Follow us on Twitter. The handle is @groundedreason. You can come hang out on our Facebook page, start a conversation, you know, shoot the breeze, got questions, comments, let us know. Please subscribe, leave a review. Join us next week. Hopefully nothing will happen in regard to the FCC, and we can get back to talking about some technology or cord cutting or something else besides worrying about what is going to happen to the internet that we all know and love. So thanks for listening again, and we will see you next time.